ready. Come on. I'm glad that you're here tonight. I really am glad. And we've got a lot of people joining us actually from coast to coast and a whole lot of states in between via live stream. Hello, you. And I'm always intrigued looking at the international audience. I mean, I love seeing all the different states, but so far tonight, we already have folks from Colombia. Okay, listo por la palabra, me voy a predicar un mensaje, tengo fuego en mis huesos. We have Samoa, we have Australia, we've got Barbados, Germany, France, and Japan so far. Welcome to all of you, so good to have you with us. I'd like to really encourage you about next weekend as well. A friend of mine, longtime friend, Dr. Air Bernard, we've been friends for, I don't know, 20-something years. We actually met in Zimbabwe and became friends, and I've spoken at his church a number of times in New York, and over the years he's been with us, and so he's going to be here doing all the services on the weekend. I think you're going to really like him. Different flavor. He's brilliant. He's a man of the word, sort of flies under the radar, but is very influential, so really glad to have him with us. And that's this coming weekend. And tonight, we're actually going to be doing number 5 on the ministry of angels. You may have been with us the last 3 Wednesdays. Well, we did number 4 on the weekend. So you can, you know, listen to the podcast or pick up a CD or whatever you do if you happen to miss number 4, because that was on the weekend. So we're going to do 5 tonight, and we're going to finish up the series next Wednesday night. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we just set our hearts to listen. Increase us, Lord, spiritually. Increase us that our influence for you and for your sake and in your name would touch more and more people. Lord, we thank you for the changes that you're going to work in our lives through your word, and we thank you for those you're going to touch through us. Jesus, above everything, we pray you would be glorified. Amen. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. If you have a Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, we're going to read a verse from there. As we begin, the Apostle Paul says something really very interesting here. 1 Corinthians 4:9, he said, "For I think that God has displayed us, the apostles, last, as men condemned to death, for we have been made a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to men." And then in 1 Timothy 5:21, he says, "I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels that you observe these things without prejudice, doing nothing with partiality." He said, we've been made a spectacle to angels, and I charge you before the elect angels. The truth is, they are present and they are watching. They see what goes on in our lives, but the good news is they're not just silent, uninterested observers. They're active participants in the drama of life, especially in the lives of those that follow Christ. We found out over the lessons we've actually hit on a number of times, Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "Angels are all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for those who will inherit salvation." Other translations say they assist those that will inherit salvation. They'll care for those. They'll minister to those that inherit salvation. It's interesting. If you read through the scriptures, we find them active participants in the drama of life and redemption throughout history. 34 of the Bible's 66 books talk about angels in detail. Every New Testament writer confirms their existence. Jesus spoke on numerous occasions about the present and future ministry of angels, and we have several instances of angels intervening in his life and directly ministering to his needs. The word angel occurs over 250 times in Scripture. My point in all of that, this is not some obscure hidden doctrine. This is a big part of what God has done, what He is doing, and what He will do. And it's something that we need to find out about. And tonight, we're going to look at angels in connection with receiving strength and guidance. Are you ready? All right. Psalm 103 and verse 20, and we've looked at that verse already. It declares that angels excel in strength. Psalm 103 and 20, angels excel in strength. 2 Thessalonians 1 and 7 says they are mighty. Now, they not only are mighty and excel in strength, they impart God's strength to people. One of our previous lessons, we spent quite a while in the book of Daniel looking at angelic intervention in his life, and he was reading the scroll of Jeremiah and realized that Israel's captivity was to last only 70 years, and he got the calendars out and figured, hey, time's up. So he gets on his face and begins to see God, and God sends an angel to give him some instructions about the Messiah, and there was just a whole lot of things in connection with it that we found out, some intriguing things, actually. But we read this, but didn't really concentrate on it last time. In Daniel 10, in verse 17, he says this, "As for me, no strength remains in me now, nor is any breath left in me. Then again, the one having the likeness of a man touched me and strengthened me. And he said, O man, greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Be strong. Yes, be strong. So when he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, let my Lord speak, for you have strengthened me." Daniel was touched and spoken to by the angel, and both of those acts of the angel brought strength to him. Now, I would like to go through a number of places in the Bible, maybe sort of rapid fire, but I want you to really listen, because this is honestly just a fraction of the instances we could look at where angels intervene in the lives of people. I want to begin looking in Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. We all know the story. It says, "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry." Well, I guess so. And then it says, "And the tempter came to him," and we know the story. He says, "Hey, if you're really the Son of God, turn these stones into bread." And Jesus responds by quoting the word. It's written, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." And several other, temptations follow that. Throw yourself down from the temple. Hey, bow down and worship me. I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. That's what you came for anyway, isn't it? You can take a shortcut. You don't have to go God's way. I'll just give it to you. And at the end of those temptations, Jesus had successfully resisted. And it says this in verse 11, "Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him." I like that. How many of you would like to have the devil leave and angels come? Yeah, the devil left and angels came. Some of you came in here tormented by the devil. I'm telling you, the devil's going to leave. Angels are going to come. So angels come and they minister to Jesus. And then we find again, Luke 22. Here he's in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he's praying about the consecration of his life to the pathway the Father has chosen, the pathway that would lead to the cross. And it says this in verse 41, "And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground." All right? In verse 41, Jesus prayed. In verse 44, Jesus prayed more earnestly. Now, I don't know how that's possible, but that's what the scripture says. Jesus, the Son of God, prayed, And then he prayed more earnestly. And in between praying and more earnest praying, what do we have? An angel coming and imparting strength to him. We don't want to pass over these things. God has inserted them in the scriptures and showed us the story so that we would contemplate it, so that we would recognize it, get a glimpse into what happens in the spirit realm. During this critical, pivotal time, an angel was instrumental in helping Jesus by giving him strength. And there's a few things that stand out to me from these two references that we just read in Matthew and here in Luke of angels intervening and ministering to Jesus. And I believe that the two occasions reveal times when we especially need to receive strength from God. Number one, when we are in the wilderness. When you're in the wilderness, my friend, you need strength from God. That's that place where you feel isolated and alone, where you're being assaulted by temptations. Jesus was tempted in the areas of physical appetite, pride, and presumption. And maybe you're there right now. Ways of temptation are enticing you and pressuring you. Maybe in the area of sexual appetite, maybe physical appetite, maybe any number of things, and you feel like you are alone in the wilderness. I think we've all been there. We understand that. It's a place where there is no natural help. But I'm telling you, in the wilderness, there is supernatural help. You may not find a man or a woman that can help you, but my friend, there are unseen messengers sent from God that will strengthen you in your wilderness. Many times, I have been burdened and suddenly felt relieved and strengthened. And I am quite convinced that it was due to the ministry of angels. Somebody says, well, did you see them? No. In fact, in 43 years, I have seen angels three times. I talked about one of the instances in a previous message. That's not a whole lot in 43 years. And those glimpses were very brief. But whether they're seen or unseen, they are still there. And their ministry is very, very real. There are angels present in this place here. And you may feel like right now you are so alone, the whole world is against you. Well, I got good news. The whole world is not against you. There are a few neutral countries. But listen, if you feel like everyone is against you right now, God is for you. He said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And I believe even now, some of you that have felt so isolated and your wilderness experience has been so harsh and you feel like you've been beaten from pillar to post, I'm telling you, I believe there are angels in this place tonight. I believe it is ordained by God that you be here, and you're going to find strength that you didn't have when you came in. You're going to find a fresh strength before you leave this place. Now, secondly, I see from these passages that we read that we need strength from God at points of sacrifice and fresh consecration. Whenever we're called upon by God to sacrifice or make some sort of a fresh consecration, in Gethsemane we read, Jesus knew what the Father was asking of him, but in his humanity he was grappling with the enormity of it. God, if there's another way, let this cup pass from me. I don't want to be cut off from your bright presence. We have enjoyed fellowship and intimacy from eternity past. And Jesus was grappling with the gravity of what God was asking. Now for us, that could be God is dealing with you about giving a large sum somewhere into his kingdom. And you know that if you obey him, it is going to impact your lifestyle, at least temporarily. It's not just, okay, I'm given a gift and I'm not going to feel that, but you have a sense that God is calling you to do something extraordinary, and you're going to have to put some of your dreams on hold unless God does something supernatural, and you may have to alter your lifestyle a bit. You need strength from God during those seasons. You know, one night, this is years ago, one of our pastors was preaching about the woman, you know, who gave her last few cents, and the scripture says even all her living, all she had. And I'm following along in my Bible, and when he said that, it seemed to jump off the page at me. And honestly, my first reaction was, oh no. God, you're not saying to me what I think you're saying. I had this thought come to me, you need to give everything you have away, everything you have in savings, everything. And Janet and I had been saving up, and we had some plans, and I didn't have an automobile at the time, and I prayed for 2 weeks hoping it would go away. It's true. But instead of go away, the sense that we need to do this became stronger and stronger. And at the end of 2 weeks, I was more convinced than I was the night the scripture stood out to me. And so I went and talked to my wife. Now, you need to understand, you know, I could probably live out of the trunk of my car without too much problem. Just not that big an issue. But you know, a lot of times the gals, their identity is tied to, you know, the home or the apartment where they live, how they fix it up. And we'd been saving, and we were, you know, looking at possibly getting a vehicle for me. Like I said, I didn't have one. And Janet had all these plans she was finally going to do with the house. And I said, baby, I got to talk to you. She said, what? And I told her what happened in the service. I said, I prayed for 2 weeks. I think we're supposed to give everything into the kingdom. She said, everything? I said, yeah, everything. And she burst into tears and started to cry. I said, well, sweetheart, listen. I said, we're a team. We're in this thing together. You pray for 2 weeks. And at the end of 2 weeks, if you don't feel like it's God, no harm, no foul, we'll just carry on. We have to be in agreement because this doesn't just affect me. And she said, okay. 2 weeks she prayed, and she came and said, Bayless, I prayed for 2 weeks, and I don't get anything. But if you feel like it's God, let's do it. Now, I guarantee you she needed some strength in that season. It was a much bigger sacrifice for her than it was for me. And I feel like God just really helped her. And you know, it didn't happen immediately, but God blessed us through that act of obedience. Now, it might be that. It might be, you know, a move to another location, a change of careers, you know, committing something major to God that you know is going to affect you. During those seasons where God's asking for some kind of a fresh consecration or asking some sacrifice of you, there is strength available, because some of those things, frankly, we just can't do it in our own natural ability, in our flesh. Everything within us wants to recoil to those things, but God's saying, no, I want you to take a massive step of faith, but there's going to be some unseen messengers that are going to help you over the hump. And before it's all said and done, I'm going to take care of you. Now, number one, in the wilderness, when you're facing temptation, number two, when called upon to sacrifice or make a fresh consecration. Now, the other thing that stands out to me about these occasions of angelic intervention in the life of Jesus is what Jesus was doing when it happened. First, he was praying. Just like Daniel was praying and the angel came. Numbers 20 and verse 16 says, when we cried out to the Lord, he heard our voice and sent the angel. Jesus was praying there in Gethsemane. The second thing he was doing in the wilderness, he was speaking the word. Said to the devil, it is written, and Jesus quoted scripture. Spoke to the devil again, and he quoted scripture. Spoke to the devil again, said, it is written. He's quoting the word. And we looked in Psalm 103 in verse 20 that angels, they do God's word, they fulfill God's word, and they heed the voice of his word. Literally, they listen to the spoken word of God. They move into action when God's word is spoken. And Jesus was doing both of those things. Jesus was praying, he was speaking the word, and we find angels suddenly appearing and imparting strength to him. All right, let's move on to the second area, angels and guidance. Now, there's a lot of examples in the Old Testament, but let's just look at a few in the New Testament. I do want to read quite a few verses, as I mentioned. Going to begin in Matthew chapter 1. I want to read verses 18 to 20 and then verse 24. says, now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. Verse 24, then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took to him his wife. Chapter 2, verse 13. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt. Stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. Verse 19. Now when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the young child's life are dead. Then he arose, took the young child and his mother, and came into the land of Israel. Now, God knows the secret plans of everyone's heart. He sees it all. God knew what Herod was going to do, and God warned and guided Joseph and Mary through an angel appearing to Joseph in a dream. We come into the New Testament. In Acts chapter 5, the church has been born. And let me just mention this. Even if God doesn't give us the why, we should still obey. I mean, we were singing a little while ago, you say, go and I will go. But Lord, why? He doesn't always say why. Sometimes he just says, go. Abraham went out not knowing where he was going, the scripture says. Here, Acts chapter 5, verse 17, it's been an interesting time for the church. There's been miracles. Salvations are occurring. The church is actually held in high esteem by all the people in Jerusalem. But some of the Jewish religious leaders are upset and they want to put a lid on the thing. They don't want any more people converting to Christianity or following Jesus as the Messiah for them. They don't want to see any more miracles. And it says in verse 17 of Acts 5, then the high priest rose up and all those who were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and they were filled with indignation, laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But at night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. Is it going to be dangerous? Maybe. I mean, the leaders have just taken them and put them in prison. What's going to happen next? But like I said, if God says go, we need to go. If God says speak up, we need to speak up. We come to Acts chapter 8, verse 26. It says, now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, arise, go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert. Now I want to stop right there. Here's an instance. God didn't give any why at all. Philip has gone to the city of Samaria and a revival has broken out. You can read about it in the book of Acts. It's amazing. The whole city, the Bible says, is filled with joy over what's been happening. And not only that, there's miracles taking place, notable miracles are taking place. People are being baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking in other tongues, and people are being water baptized. I mean, the whole city is shaken, and an angel says to Philip, okay, time to go. At the pinnacle of this revival, he's told to leave. Know why? God, the city is shaken. Nothing's ever happened like this before. This is amazing. And you want me to go to the desert? There's nothing there? Let's read on. It says, go from Jerusalem to Gaza, which is desert. So he arose and went. And behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury, and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot when he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, go near and overtake this chariot. Now, of course, we know the story. He was converted to Christ. Philip baptized him in water. And he was directed by an angel to go out there. A tradition has it that this man was the very first one to bring the gospel to Ethiopia. So now he's the key, not just to a city, but to a nation. It's not just a door to a city, it's a door to a nation has been opened, directed by angels. I talked to a lady one day. She was so excited. She said, coming to this church has changed my life. I've gotten saved, and this has happened, and that's happened. She says, I don't have words to describe. I used to battle with depression. I'm free. And she just went on and on, just beside herself. I said, well, how did you get here? She said, it's funny that you ask. I was crying out to God in my depression for help, and a voice said to me, get in your car and drive. She said, I got in my car, and I started to drive. And I just felt like I should turn here, turn there, turn here. She says, and I ended up in the parking lot of the church. Now, this was in our old building. And there was service going on. She says, I didn't know there was a church here. And so I came in, gave her life to Christ, and God turned her whole world, I was going to say upside down, turned it right side up for her. Now, did she see an angel? I don't think so, but I wouldn't doubt that an angel spoke to her. You know, most of you probably heard the story that if you've been here at any time at all, I share it fairly often. As a new believer, I was down in Mexico, involved in some crusade work, had big, big crusades during the evenings, and I was just a helper. But I was down at the beach one free afternoon we had, and everybody's goofing around down there, and I had the wheels. I had an old 63 microbus, so I was the Uber. And a voice said to me, drive south. And I knew it was from God. I said, everybody in the van. I said, where are we going? I said, we're going south. They said, why? I said, just get in. I wasn't going to tell them I heard a voice. We all got in. We're driving south. Actually, this is from Ensenada, so we're driving down the coastal road there south. And this maniac starts honking his horn and almost trying to, like, you know, make me veer off the road. So I pull off the side of the road. He pulls in behind me. I used to have this little bumper sticker on the back of my van that said, I'd rather be with Jesus. And he saw that bumper sticker, and God told him to pull me over. He happened to be a pastor down in the next town, Mañadero. And so we went and spent about an hour down there. He had a little compound, a nice little church building. And we had a good time, prayed for his family. In fact, his name was Sostenes Cordero. Still remember him. We came back and went up. This is hours, like maybe the crusade's going to take place in 4 or 5 hours now. So we go to the crusade site, and the evangelist, the preacher, comes over to me and the people I'm with. He said, I don't know why, but I feel like the Holy Spirit told me I need to talk to you, that somehow you have the answer. We said, the answer to what? He said, well, the police came up this morning and they closed the crusade down. They said, we're practicing medicine without a license because we're praying for the sick, and we've been forbidden to carry on with the crusade. He says, this seems crazy, but somehow I think you have the answer. We said, well, we did meet a guy down in the next town, Mañadero, that he's got a compound. We could probably get in touch with him and carry on. We drove down there, got in touch with him, and actually word of mouth got out. Crusade went on that night, but down in Mañadero, in the little town, that little church building was filled. The courtyard was filled. People were peeking in the windows. A bunch of people got saved. There was some notable healings that took place. Now, somebody says, Pastor, are you saying an angel talked to you to drive south? I think so. I didn't see him. But the Bible doesn't tell us that Philip saw the angel that said, go to the desert. Right. So the angel that spoke to him. I don't know if Philip saw anything or not. He may have not seen anything. He just recognized a voice that came from heaven, and he obeyed. God will direct us, if we're open, to people that are searching, hungry, and in need. Just like God directed Philip to that Ethiopian eunuch who was actually reading a prophecy about Jesus from the book of Isaiah. He was hungering and thirsting for the truth. Philip comes up in the chariot and says, man, can you tell me what I'm reading? I don't understand this. From the same scriptures, he preaches Jesus to him and the guy gets gloriously saved. God will guide us, maybe through angels, maybe just by his Holy Spirit, but he wants to guide us because, listen, every day in your school, where you work, in the lunch break area, in your neighborhood, there are people that are hungering, some of them at their wit's end. They got their game face on when you see them, but their life is literally coming unraveled. And God wants to send a messenger to them. And I think if we're open, God will direct us and God will guide us to them because we do have answers. Here's another story, Acts chapter 10. We move right along. This is actually 10 years after the day of Pentecost. Verse 1, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what is called the Italian regiment, a devout man, one who feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people, prayed to God always. About the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God coming in and saying to him, Cornelius. And when he observed him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? So he said to him, your prayers and your alms have come up for memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa and send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He's lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. He will tell you what you must do. Send for Peter. He'll tell you what you must do. Everyone say, you must do. This is a must. This is something you have to do. You must do. So you know the story. God deals with Peter. Peter goes with him, you know, with the soldier and the other people that came from Cornelius. Goes back to Cornelius' household, finds the house filled with friends and relatives. Peter goes in, preaches Christ to them. The Holy Spirit falls. They're saved. They're baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's a glorious day. And then they're all baptized in water after that. Now, you have to realize that up to this point, 10 years after the day of Pentecost when the church was born, there are no Gentile converts in the church. The church is 100% Jewish. Now, they believe Gentiles can be saved, but only through the door of Judaism. They believe if a Gentile wants to be saved, they have to be circumcised, become a full-fledged Jewish proselyte, and then only through that door can they now enter into a relationship with Christ. And God upends this whole thing here in Cornelius' household. All these Gentiles got saved, baptized in the Holy Spirit, then baptized in water, and none of them had first become Jewish proselytes. It was unheard of. So Peter comes back to Jerusalem, to the mother church, and a whole bunch of the believers there are irate. And they said, hey, we heard you went into a Gentile's house and you ate with them. Peter said, yep, guess I did. And then he tells the story and relates what happened. And it's interesting as he tells the story, but I just want to pull out one part. In Acts chapter 11, here Peter's telling what happened, verses 13 and 14. And he's talking about Cornelius. It says, and he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house who said to him, send men to Joppa and call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved. Now, Peter's elaborating and giving a little more detail. He said, the angel said, go see Peter. He's going to tell you words whereby you and your household be saved. Well, why didn't the angel just tell Cornelius those words? I mean, he was already with him. You know, why send all the way over to the seaside for Peter? I mean, Mr. Angel, you're right there. Why don't you tell Cornelius the words he needs to hear whereby he can be saved? And for that matter, why didn't the angel just go to the Ethiopian eunuch and tell him what the prophecy was about? Why didn't he preach Jesus? And for that matter, why did the angel tell the apostles, go into the temple and speak all the words of this life? Mr. Angel, why don't you go into the temple and speak all the words of this life? It's because we have been commissioned to go into all the world and preach, not angels. We have been given a cargo that is more precious than every treasure that was ever carried on any ship in the history of the world. God has ordained and chosen that the infallible message be preached by fallible men and women, and by that means, people would be saved. Wonder of wonders, men once lost in sin, redeemed by the precious blood, are to be the carriers and proclaimers of the gospel of life. Not that angels wouldn't like to do it. It's just not their assignment. Listen to this. 1 Peter 1 and 12. It's talking about the prophets of long ago. To them it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us, they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Things which angels desire to look into. Redemption, the gospel. It literally means that angels long to look into these things. Angels, they long for a personal, intimate understanding of what we sometimes take for granted. But they can never fully know what it's about. An angel can never understand fully the grace and the forgiveness of God to be lost in sin, separated from God, and then redeemed and washed clean and made a part of God's family. No angel could ever preach it the way someone who has personally tasted it could preach it. Angels are, however, involved in some aspects of redemption, influencing people to come to a place so they can hear the gospel, like here, like now, tonight. Bringing people to a place where they can meet a carrier of the gospel. You know, when I got saved, I came out of a wild and woolly life of drug addiction and a bunch of other craziness. And if you stood still long enough, I talked to you. If I ever had the thought, if I looked at somebody and the thought crossed my mind, need to witness to them, I just assumed the devil would never inspire me to witness somebody, so I just went for it. And I lived in Ashland, Oregon, and there was a boulevard down the street called Siskiyou Boulevard, and there was a hitchhiking station kind of down near the main part of town. And that's where if you wanted to ride, so people would sort of wait in line there and hitchhike, and people would pick them up. So there's the hitchhiking station, there's a little grass hill there, and I looked at a guy, and the thought crossed my mind. I need to talk to that guy. He's laying up on the hill. And so I walked up to him and said, "Hey, man, how you doing?" And he was very engaging because I looked just like him. He thought I was one of the pack. I mean, I had a long beard. I had long hair with braids in it, feathers in my hair. "What's going on, man?" And he probably thought I was going to try and buy some weed from him. And I said, "Hey, God told me to come over here and talk to you about his son, Jesus." And I shared my testimony with him. And this guy completely rebuffed me. I mean, he was nasty about it, and like, he turned it off. I said, "Well, man, you just need to know God loves you, and he won't quit on you." So I walk away, think, well, seed planted, you know, it's not my job to win him. It's my job to plant the seed. Anyway, that night, it's around dusk, and I've got some friends in my van, and a voice spoke to me. We're driving to a particular location, and I felt like I was supposed to drive up a road I'd never been up before. I turned up the road and said, what are we doing? This isn't the way there. I said, "Come on, just hang with me." It's true. Driving up that road, got to another road. I felt like, turn right. I turn right. Another road, turn left. And I'm out in an area, rural area I've never been before. Then turn, and I mean, it's getting really dark now. Turn, go down, and it goes to a locked fence. There's a gate that's locked. So I get out of the van, I'm standing there and sort of peering in the darkness, and I recognize it's a vineyard. I didn't even know there was a vineyard there. There's this hidden vineyard, you know, back in the hills, and I can barely make out the sort of silhouette of a shack on the other side of the vineyard, and all of a sudden, somebody lights an old kerosene lamp over there. I can see the light of the lamp. And it started, whoever it was, they're coming across the field, walking across the vineyard. I can see that kerosene lamp swinging in the darkness. All I can see is this light coming. And we're standing there on the other side of this locked gate. And the guy, he gets pretty close, or she, or whoever, and I can't see anything because the light's so bright. Holds it up and it shines on our faces. And this is what the person says. Oh, no. And then he shines the light on himself. It was the guy from the hitchhiking station. And I laughed. I said, I told you. He says, I guess you better come in. And so he unlocks the gate. We went across the vineyard, sat down in his little house. He was the caretaker of the vineyard. He put a pot of coffee on, and we drank coffee for an hour, maybe an hour and a half, and talked to him about Jesus. Now, he didn't get saved, but he sure had reason to. God wants to direct us to people. I believe he brought you here. And then here's another aspect of angelic involvement. You know, the Bible says if we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in our heart God raised from the dead, we'll be saved. We understand about the power of the confession of the Lordship of Jesus. Listen to this. Jesus said it, Luke 12, verses 8 and 9. Also I say to you, whoever confesses me before men, him the Son of Man also will confess before the angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. And then in Luke 15, 10, Jesus said, likewise I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. They are involved. Now, just back up to a moment. I'm going to bring this to a close. Think about Cornelius. Cornelius, the Bible says he was devout and he feared God. He had a genuine respect for God, but he wasn't saved. The angel said, you send for Peter. Peter will tell you words whereby you must be saved. Wasn't saved yet. He had to hear the gospel in order to be saved. But he's devout. He really did respect God. He taught his family. He said he feared God with all of his house. He taught his children to have a respect and reverence for God, but he wasn't saved. He lived out the faith that he had in front of his soldiers. When he sent people to get Peter, the Bible says he sent devout servants and a devout soldier. So this guy's not ashamed, you know, about his faith in God, even in front of his troops. But he's not saved. The scripture says he prayed always, but he wasn't saved. There's a lot of people that pray earnestly to God. My mama prayed to God. She believed in the God of the Bible. She wasn't a Christian. She got saved later on, but she did believe in the God of the Bible. She just never heard the gospel. The Bible said he gave alms generously, meaning he gave to the poor. He was generous, but he wasn't saved. There's people that are very, very generous, even towards noble things like taking care of the poor, but you can't buy salvation with your generosity. And the scripture says that he had an angelic visitation, but he wasn't saved. And there are people that have had genuine spiritual experiences. Some have seen angels. Some have had divine visitations. But you have to hear and believe words in order to be saved. God has chosen that through the foolishness of preaching, men would be saved. Not an angel preaching to you, but a man. So a man had to come and preach to Cornelius. And it happened to be a man that had made more than his fair share of mistakes. Well, tonight, listen. I'm your man. I'm your man. Yeah, we got a fallible vessel, but we got an infallible message. There's a God in heaven that knows your name. He knows everything about you. He knew the first thought in your mind when you woke up this morning. He knew the last thing you thought about before you drifted off to sleep last night. Those that are in here that you don't sleep well, you thrash, you turn, you've got insomnia, God knows about that, and he wants to help you. There's some people in here, you've done some very dark things that you just don't want anybody to know about. God already knows, and he still loves you. He loves you, and he sent his son to die for you, to redeem you. Nothing we can do in and of ourselves can bring us into a right relationship with God. Not our generosity, not our devotedness, not anything we can do, not our good works. It's through faith in His Son, Jesus. Jesus paid the price on Calvary's tree for all of us. Once the price was paid, God raised Him from the dead. And the Scripture says, if you believe it and you're willing to confess Him as Lord, God brings you into a relationship, and God calls that relationship salvation. Not about ritual, not about ceremony, not about rules and regulations. It's about having a walking, talking, living, breathing relationship with your Creator. God wants you. He won't turn you away if He'll come. Why don't you bow your heads, close your eyes just for a minute. Now, you've heard the message. It's up to you to believe. No one can do that for you. God has no grandchildren, only children. You may be a preacher's kid. That won't get you into heaven. Your grandpa may have been a firebrand of a preacher, and you were raised under the influence of gospel ministry, but you have to make a personal decision. On the other hand, you may have never darkened a church door before this very night. And just something has awakened in you, a spark, an ember has been lit in you. And I just want to fan that into flame, my friend. God is reaching out to you. Jesus said, come. If you're thirsty, come. If you're hungry spiritually, He says, come. And He will satisfy that thirst. He will satisfy that hunger. Tell you what, right now, everybody just put a hand on your heart. Let's let our hearts go up to God. Father, we just come. We recognize our frailty. We realize how limited we are and how gracious You are. And we come just as we are, realizing that You're reaching down to us, offering so much. If we'll just believe. Church, tie your heart around this prayer. Sir, ma'am, tie your heart around this prayer. If you want to connect with your Creator, say it out loud. Say, oh God, I come to You. I have nothing to offer, but still I come. I believe what You said in the Bible, that salvation is for all who come. That whosoever believes can have eternal life. I do believe. I believe Jesus Christ is Your Son. And I want the gift of eternal life. I want to have a relationship with You. So I bow my heart to Jesus Christ. I call Him Lord. And I submit my will to Him. Jesus' name. Amen. So good. So good. All right. A couple of things, we'll let you go. I worked pretty hard to not go over tonight. I mean, the band, they're waiting in the wings. I said, if I don't go long, I'll call you, but they're just going to have to wait. I know there'll be people. I didn't have you raise a hand or do anything tonight, but honestly, God saw your heart. And God would set up a whole evening just to touch you. I got saved in a street mission. It was filled with people. Some people there for a free meal, some people drug addicts, quite a few homeless people, bunch of alcoholics. I was the only one that responded and came forward when somebody gave an invitation that night. Nobody else went but me. I think God loves me enough that He would set that whole night up for me. I mean, it was available to anyone, but I think we need to understand how much He values us. You're not just a face in the crowd ever to God. You're not a number on an endless list. God knows you intimately. He's concerned about the issues of your life. He wants to help you. Obviously, He wants to help you spiritually first to become strong and have a great relationship. But He's interested in the other stuff, the stuff we tend to worry about. You know, the finances, the kids, our health, you know, our future, security, all those things. God's interested in all that stuff. And Jesus knows what it is to be in a flesh and blood body. It's like God's not aloof and, you know, think, well, you know, what's your problem? He gets it. And so I just want you to go in the knowledge that you're loved by God, that he's for you, he's not against you. And if you did pray that prayer and really meant it, we have a prayer tent right outside. We want to give you a Bible. You can go in with your whole crew. We'd love to shake your hand, find out your story, meet you. And we're just glad that you came tonight. If you're new to the church, we got a visitor's tent. Love to shout you a cup of coffee, a cup of tea, and say hi and get to know you out there too. And if you've been in the wilderness, there's strength for you. If God's calling you to some sort of a sacrifice or a fresh consecration that you know is going to impact you, there's strength for you. Let me let you go with a prayer. Father, I pray that you strengthen your people. For those that have been in the wilderness, I pray that the heaviness would leave and that angels would come. I pray that the darkness would be dispelled and light from heaven would come. And God, for those that are in a season of sacrifice, a season of consecration, I pray that you'd strengthen them, that carry this thing over the finish line and actually get done what you're calling them to do. And I pray that there'd be great blessing in it for them, Heavenly Father, even if not apparent at the moment. If they're willing to be a blessing to someone else, we know that you'll bless them. So as your people go, Father, may they go with a fresh sense of your presence. May this word ring out in our hearts for days, weeks, and months to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great night.